Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Chris Eisgruber, Princeton University President.
Well, good morning. I'm pleased to be able to welcome you to this third annual Princeton Fung Global Forum. As I think you know, the focus of this year's forum is a challenging and urgent one. We will address the 2014 outbreak of the Ebola virus in Western Africa, as well as other recent plagues, with the goal of identifying methods for averting future crises. The topic of Ebola provides a lens through which we can discuss the critical issues facing many aspects of global health today. Recent viral outbreaks, Ebola, avian flu, and the respiratory syndromes known as SARS and MERS, have presented the world with a formidable quandary. Resolving these crises requires a multidisciplinary approach involving not only public health and medical knowledge, but also an understanding of the economic, environmental, political, and historical roots and consequences of these plagues. This conference will bring all these perspectives together in the hopes of identifying methods for avoiding future crises. My colleagues at the Woodrow Wilson School for Public and International Affairs and its Center for Health and Well-being have put together a stellar program featuring world leaders in public health crisis management. I'm also pleased to say that they have brought with them a number of our undergraduate and graduate students from Princeton University who are involved in the Center for Health and Well-being and whom I'm sure would be willing to talk to any of you about it during the breaks or at other times. Unlike many other conferences addressing disease control, this year's Fung Forum takes an interdisciplinary view of the issues. Over the next 2 days, you will hear experts from a broad range of fields, including history, economics, politics, medical research, and public health. The scholars, leaders, and policymakers who have gathered for this conference are aware of the many challenges presented by modern plagues, and they have given considerable thought to coming up with creative solutions. They will certainly address the role of medical science in preventing and treating plagues, but they will also discuss the role of information technology, politics, and money in relief efforts. And now it's my pleasure to introduce the man whose vision and generosity have made this conference possible, William Fung of Princeton's great class of 1970. You deserve a longer and fuller introduction than that, William, so I'm going to say a bit more. Princeton is very appreciative of William's generous gift to the university in 2012 to further our engagement with the international scholarly community and to inspire collaborative analysis of important global issues. That gift has enabled us to host the Fung Forum this year and annually. Last year in Paris, we addressed the future of higher education. In 2013, we convened in Shanghai to discuss the future of the city. William's gift also established the Fung Global Fellows Program, which brings exceptional international scholars to Princeton for a year of research, writing, and collaboration. William has for many years been engaged with issues of globalization, both through his affiliation with Princeton and in his professional life. He is group chairman of Li & Fung, a Hong Kong-based multinational group of export and retailing companies. The company, founded by his grandfather in 1906, is a world leader in consumer goods design, development, sourcing, and distribution, with more than 300 offices and distribution centers in some 40 countries. William served as a Princeton trustee from 2009 to 2013. In addition to his gift to establish the Fung Forum and the Global Fellows Program, his generous support of the university has extended to our groundbreaking financial aid program, which has enabled us to expand access to a Princeton education to a wider variety of talented students. We at Princeton are profoundly thankful for the support and the visionary thinking that William has provided to us over the years, and I am personally grateful for his friendship and his counsel about our international initiatives. Please join me in welcoming William Fung.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, fellow Princetonians. It's indeed a great honor and pleasure for me to be standing here today to introduce this forum. I am so grateful for the opportunity to be able to play a small role in facilitating this kind of fora, you know, around the world, basically showing Princeton to the rest of the world and interacting with the rest of the world of Princeton. Being a foreign student, you know, in the class of 1970, I am so grateful for the teaching that I had received at Princeton. Now, in terms of something to talk to you that's meaningful, as you know, I'm a business guy, so I'm not going to be able to contribute to this conversation. Other than the fact that perhaps, like any typical inquisitive Princetonian, I come to this forum with some things in mind, is that I would like to have four questions I'd like to ask, and I'd like to get insights into, you know, with this forum. The first one, okay, is the question of, are plagues inevitable? I remember my Economics 101 class and the Malthusian trap. Okay, according to Thomas Malthus, okay, the outcome of a growing population in the world and with limited global resources is either war, famine, or disease. So one of my questions for today would be, are plagues inevitable? And they have been around for a long time. The second question I have is that, what are the causes of modern plagues? Okay, with the Ebola, you know, with the bird flu and the SARS that was mentioned, it seems like a lot of these plagues are, I guess, what the biologists would call zoonotic, you know, coming from animals. But, or are some of them man-made? You know, that is the question I have. You know, Ebola, bird flu, swine flu, SARS, you know, I experienced that personally myself in 2002 in Hong Kong. I was in Hong Kong when SARS hit Hong Kong. And now recently MERS, I was in Korea. And that economy was somewhat devastated for a period of 6 to 9 months because of the emergence of MERS, which came from the Middle East in Korea. But I also ask myself, you know, I do read a lot about things like the FT some time ago, the Financial Times some time ago, says that there's an antibiotics apocalypse going on. How much of our problems are due to overuse of antibiotics and therefore leading to mutation of some very common infections that might turn into epidemics? Okay, so that's another question that I would love to get insight on today. The third one is, how difficult or easy is it to contain epidemics? You know, I was luckily I was upstairs having breakfast, and I met this very interesting Woodrow Wilson person, Carl LaRue. And he said that perhaps some of the preventions are the simplest that you could imagine. Since then, I've thought of several. I mean, he talked about something called oral rehydration, which is to saving many, many babies in Bangladesh. All they needed was to be rehydrated. But I also think of, I remember that Dr. Semmelweis, who's an Austrian doctor 100 years ago, basically just taught physicians to wash their hands properly, you know, and that's apparently stopped some kind of an epidemic with pregnant mothers, because these doctors, I was just told this morning, that they were doing autopsies in the morning and then examining the pregnant women afterwards and passing on, and as a result led to a whole epidemic. Other examples would be things like the use of a condom. You know, that hopefully would contain some epidemic. And then in Asia, maybe less so in the West, it's very common to wear a face mask if you have any kind of respiratory problem yourself or you don't want to catch anything. And that's a common habit. If you go to Japan, Korea, China, there are people walking around the streets with face masks because of that. How easy or difficult is that? Of course, you have some real extreme measures as well. You know, in 2002 in Hong Kong with MERS, we were quarantining, you know, whole sections of the city. You know, the block, city block, where the infection were happening. So sometimes things are very difficult. And how difficult is it in the globalized world, where people get on a plane and could be in any city in the world in terms of spreading diseases? So this is another area that I would hope to find out more about and learn more about myself. And finally, the fourth question, okay, what are the social, political, and economic impact, you know, of plagues? This is what Chris alluded to, and hence the multidisciplinary resources that we're bringing to bear on this question. You know, I remember, again, from my education at Princeton, the Black Death, 1350s, right? In the 1350s, the Black Death wiped out a third of Europe's population. It took Europe 150 years to recover from that. And it totally upset the whole social, economic, you know, and political institutions in Europe for centuries. So I think all that, the impact of these plagues are certainly something that would be, I think, very interesting for me as a part of the audience. And last night, we had a tour, went to see the Book of Kells. And let me quote you something which I read on the exhibit right in front of the door. It says, between 700 and 900 AD, with an improvement in the climate and the absence of plagues, the Irish society became increasingly stable. Now, how appropriate is that for what we are talking about? This was just last night from looking at the Book of Kells. But I am certainly looking forward to this. I'd like to thank you all for attending. I'm very excited that we can bring this, the experts that we are going to bring on the stage to talk about it. And thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, William, once again for your generosity and for framing so well a number of the questions that will occupy us for the next couple of days. It's now my great pleasure to introduce Cecilia Rouse, the Dean of the Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs at Princeton, who will chair this conference. Cece is the Lawrence and Shirley Katzman and Lewis and Anna Ernst Professor in the Economics of Education and also Professor of Economics and Public Affairs at Princeton University. As she noted last night, we have a number of titles at Princeton that are hard to fit on business cards, and hers is one of those. She is a visionary academic leader and a superb dean for the school. She is also an extraordinary scholar and teacher who has produced groundbreaking research on labor economics with a focus on the economics of education. Cece graduated from Harvard University with a PhD in economics, and she joined the faculty of the Woodrow Wilson School in 1992. She has served as an editor of the Journal of Labor Economics and is currently a senior editor of The Future of Children, a policy journal published by the Wilson School and the Brookings Institution. She is the founding director of the Princeton University Education Research Section, a member of the National Academy of Education, and a research associate of the National Bureau of Economic Research. Dean Rouse has also demonstrated a strong commitment to public service. In 1998 to 99, she served in the White House at the National Economic Council, and from 2009 to 2011, she served as one of three members of President Barack Obama's Council of Economic Advisors. Cece began her tenure as dean of the Woodrow Wilson School in September 2012. She is a gifted scholar, educator, and public speaker, and we are very fortunate to have her leading this conference. Please join me in welcoming Dean Cecilia Rouse.
Good morning. It's my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Peter Piatt, a microbiologist and director of the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine and professor of global health. In the course of his illustrious career, he has served as the Undersecretary General of the United Nations, founding executive director of UNAIDS, and the joint UN program on HIV/AIDS, and president of the International AIDS Society. After graduating from medical school, Dr. Piatt co-discovered the Ebola virus in Zaire in 1976 and helped lead the efforts to contain the first ever recorded Ebola epidemic. His research led him to a distinguished academic and scientific career focusing on AIDS and women's health in the developing world. Drawing on his skills as a scientist, manager, and activist, Dr. Piatt has challenged world leaders to view AIDS in the context of social and economic development, as well as security. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Peter Piatt.
Thank you, Cece. Thank you very much, Cece, and good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for inviting me to what is going to be, I think, the very different session on Ebola and on epidemics than any of the ones that, the numerous ones that I've attended. So that in itself is already a great start. And because as William Funk said, this is more than about microbiology, more than about microbes, but it's about societies and so on. And I was asked to give an introduction mostly to the science and where are we with the knowledge in terms of Ebola and other pandemics. And when I was in my last year in medical school, I'm from Belgium, and I was went to consult my professors for what today we call career counseling. I don't think that word existed in these days. And the verdict was unanimous. No future in infectious diseases. And yet, you know, I was fascinated by epidemics, by microbes and so on, and being slightly stubborn, but also believing that you have to follow your passion and what you're really interested in, I went for it, and the medical school went into infectious diseases training and microbiology. And then 2 years later, my life changed when this is from Google Images, so it's not the original one, but a thermos arrived and was dropped at the reception of a clinical microbiology lab in Antwerp, where I was then in training, and dropped by a pilot coming straight from Kinshasa. And this thermos contained two glass vials. One was broken. There was no plastic in these days also. The blood and the vials were swimming in water and some ice cubes. And with a little piece of paper with a question mark, is this yellow fever or not? And it's blood that came from a Flemish nun, a missionary, who had died with what looked like yellow fever clinically, but wasn't sure. And we were certified to work with arboviruses. These are viruses that are transmitted by arthropods, by some kind of insects. And so we did the usual things for in terms of virology in these days, which was not very sophisticated. You inject mice and guinea pigs and put it on cells. Today that's all far more precise and faster. And what came out of it was the first isolate of Ebola virus that we found, and you can see this, the shape of it under the electron microscope was very unusual for a virus. Because most viruses are spheres or a bit square. And in these days, again, we had to go to the library to consult an atlas of viruses because we couldn't Google it. It looked like Marburg virus, and then we got the news from WHO that we had to stop all investigations because there was an epidemic of hemorrhagic fever going on in what was then called Zaire, the Democratic Republic of Congo now, and we were definitely not equipped, you know, not a maximum security laboratory, and send everything through basically Federal Express to the Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta. For all that, you would go to jail today. You can't transport this kind of dangerous specimens across borders. And at the Centers for Disease Control, they could confirm that this was a new virus, which was then called Ebola, after a river in near the epidemic, the center. So then I went to Zaire to investigate what is this all about, because it's exciting to isolate and to find a new virus. But I was even more interested in finding out how is it transmitted? Is this by air, by food, by sex, by mosquitoes, blood, and so on, the usual ways that microbes and pathogens are transmitted. And that's, of course, the absolute minimal type of knowledge that you need in order to control an epidemic and to contain it. And it was also a bit scary because we didn't know for ourselves what it was. And on the left side, you can see how the protection equipment we had. We were with two. This was Pierre Sirot from Institut Pasteur in Paris and myself. We were seeing patients in their huts. And we had a paper mask, surgical latex gloves, and some motorbike goggles we had found somewhere. That was our protection compared to, on the right side, what we see today in what being used in West Africa. And to make a long story short, first of all, we could describe the, the disease itself. First of all, we had a 90% mortality rate, so case fatality rate, which was enormous, and which is still the highest of all outbreaks, and I'll tell you why that was. But we also noticed that the disease spectrum was in the beginning very mild, like any viral syndrome. It starts with headache, fever, myalgia, abdominal pain, and so on. So nothing special. This can be the flu. And it's only after a few days that, that the actual, in about 25 to 30%, there is bleeding. So hemorrhagic fever means bleeding, and with a massive attack of all organs, and the case fatality rate then was 90%. Now, in terms of the, we found in 2 days, actually, what the main modes of transmission were by asking three questions and defining the epidemic in terms of time, place, and person. How is it evolving over time? Where is it occurring? So we found that the closer you live to a particular hospital called Yambuku, the higher the risk that you were affected by Ebola. Two, that we arrived when the peak of the epidemic was over, which is the best time to arrive, actually. They think it's thanks to you. And we wonder, when did it start declining? And that's when the hospital was closed. And thirdly, when we broke down the cases by age and sex, as on this slide, in blue you've got the male patients, and in red the female patients, that there was two major observations. One, not that many children were affected. And this is an area where children under 18, 16 are about half of the population. And secondly, between 15 and 29, there were twice as many women as men. And the question was, okay, is this due, for example, because all the men or half of the men of that age are working in the cities, as you see in quite a few developing countries? That didn't turn out to be the case. And then we had to find out, what's the difference between men and women between 15 and 29? Since we were a bunch of men, it took us several hours to figure out that women can get pregnant. And indeed, it was mostly pregnant women or women who had just delivered. And then the question was, what happened to them? Why? Is this biology, some immunological phenomenon? But the answer was much simpler and actually very sobering, is that the excess of women was due to women who had attended the antenatal clinic of that hospital. All that we found out in 2 days, but then it took a week to find out that what happened is that Mother Superior would distribute 5 needles and syringes every morning for the outpatient department, and that everybody who came there got an injection, and that in between the needles and syringes were just flushed a little bit in some water. So the main mode of transmission that created and that amplified the epidemic was contaminated needles and syringes, which has not been the case in later epidemics. But that explains also the high mortality, because nobody who was most likely infected by a needle and syringe actually survived, because you get a massive dose directly in your bloodstream, which is the most effective way of infecting somebody. But we also found that other modes of transmission, attending a funeral, 1 week after a funeral, several members of the family would come down with Ebola. But also, this is from West Africa, caring for somebody with Ebola, or even touching and so on, hospital workers. 11 out of 17 hospital staff of that hospital died also, and now today we know there's also sexual transmission. Now, after that outbreak in 76, it was silent for quite a while. The next documented outbreak was in 95, again in the same country. But when you look at the theory here, it's just a very brief, simple mathematics here. When you look at the theory of transmission and at the population level of microbes, of pathogens, there's a very simple formula from Anderson and May, who actually spent some time at Princeton, actually. And the reproductive rate of a pathogen, and reproductive rate means that if it's more than one, that means that on the average, more than one person will be infected by someone who is infected. And if that's more than one, then it will amplify and you have an epidemic. If it's less than one, it'll die out. And that depends on basically three factors. First, the probability of transmission, which in the case of Ebola is quite low, because you need close contact, and you need contact with bodily fluids. Even at the beginning of illness of someone with Ebola, that person is not that infectious. But once the serious clinical manifestations become apparent, and particularly when there's vomiting and bleeding and diarrhea, it is. But very low probability of transmission. Number of contacts actually is very limited. Very limited because it's only those who care closely or go to a funeral. It's very different from in both cases. For example, if you have measles, the probability of transmission is very high. Or tuberculosis in terms of number of contacts on a bus and so on. And then duration of infectiousness, very short in the case of Ebola, because most people die within 1 week, 10 days. And so there isn't that much time to infect lots of people. Compare that with HIV, where you can be, healthy and infectious for 10 years without any treatment. So in theory, this is something, a pathogen that should not give rise to major epidemics. And that is what happened for about, 35 years, between 76 and last year. Actually, the epidemic in Guinea started in December 2013, so nearly 2 years ago. And there were a few, dogmas. One is that Ebola is a Central African issue. All epidemics, all outbreaks happened in the Democratic Republic of Congo and neighboring countries. That's the first thing. Secondly, they're limited in time, limited in space, and they are also not affecting large population, big cities. All that's changed completely, nearly 2 years ago, although we didn't know. And you can see here that after an initial silent epidemic where we didn't know, between the 23rd of December, when the first case appeared in Gekedu, a border town in Guinea, bordering with both Liberia and Sierra Leone, that it took then 3 months nearly before the diagnosis was made. And I can understand that. One, you only find what you're looking for. Nobody was looking for Ebola in West Africa. And two, the infrastructure, the laboratory infrastructure, the public health infrastructure in West Africa is in a very, very sad state. It seemed that the epidemic continued and following a usual pattern. A big difference, though, was that this was in an area with very good mobility, good roads, and where people crossed borders. It's the same family. They go to a funeral on the other side of the border or whatever, and trade and so on. And it's not until May, June that things started to change and to be very different from the rest of all the other outbreaks. So the first time, another country was affected. So there was a wave that started in Sierra Leone, end of May, and then in early June, also in Liberia. And what, for me, triggered the alarm in my own brain was that when in Conakry, the capital of Guinea, there were cases. And this is the time when MSF, Médecins Sans Frontières, Doctors Without Borders, issued an alarm and said this outbreak is out of control. And I looked at it and I said, It is different. The figures are still fairly low, I mean, in terms of the number of cases, but my gut feeling was that this was completely different because it was affecting three countries, a capital, and I thought this will be far more difficult to control, to contain, than an outbreak in a rural area where you can isolate people and so on. Once something is in the slums of Conakry and Freetown and Monrovia, that's far more difficult. And yet, the world didn't react. Also, the governments of the three countries did not really take this seriously. Again, the excuse could be they had never been confronted with this kind of situation. They were actually, in a quite a positive momentum in terms of rebuilding the nations, but there was a kind of part of denial as well. And it's then Nigeria had the case, and it's only in mid-August that WHO actually declared that this was an outbreak of public health importance. So we're about here in after about 1,500 cases had, 700 cases had cumulatively occurred. Then we started also with cases in outside the West Africa, which also was the first time. So that's how the epidemic evolved. Each country had different patterns. It's something we should also bear in mind. And even within a country, there are different patterns. Now, the first question was, is this a different virus? Because it behaves differently. Maybe it's a more virulent virus, what have you. In the meantime, we know it is absolutely the same type of Ebola, so-called Zaire strain. There are five different types of Ebola, and the Zaire one is the most virulent one and with the highest mortality. Thanks to very sophisticated genomic typing, we can follow virus isolates and how the virus circulates in a population. And without going into any detail, one, it is the same strain and the same type of Ebola as in Zaire that we've seen. But also, as time goes by, through mutations and so on, we can distinguish different types, but that are not very, very different, but that are very useful to find out whether when we find a new case, as is the case now in Guinea last week, there were three new cases. Do they belong to known transmission chains, or is this a new type of transmission chain? Before, we would not be able to do that. Today, thanks to technology, to genomic typing, we can do that. It's not a virus. What was it then? And I call this the perfect storm. It's a combination of a number of environmental, of political factors, of infrastructure, of beliefs that created this perfect storm, which were not all together happening to the same extent as in the previous epidemics. Let's not forget that we have two countries that came out of decades of civil war, Liberia and Sierra Leone, one of corrupt dictatorship in Guinea, as a result, an outflux of professionals, a collapse of health and social infrastructure, and very important, I think, a collapse of trust in governments, in anything that is coming as a message from wherever, because people think there must be something behind that, what is the agenda, and so on. And also, of course, the another factor that I mentioned already, higher mobility than ever before in where these epidemics had happened. And then I think the most important one, which is the inaction, the lack of action, and so much time was lost when you can still contain an epidemic in the beginning. And look, just as an indicator of the health system capacity, just the number of people for every doctor. Here, when you take the UK and the US, we have like 360 to 410 people per physician. In Liberia, that's 70,000 people for one. So that's just an indicator of how, in what state the health system is. Now, but that doesn't explain everything. Because when you take the Democratic Republic of Congo, which is not well known for being extremely well organized and have a great health system, they succeeded in containing an epidemic of Ebola around the same time last year, starting in August, and in 6 weeks or so they contained it. And why was that? Because they were immediate response mode. The Minister of Health himself went to the outbreak in a rural area. It was far more difficult to get out and to get in, but in the first place, they acted promptly. And I think that is a very, very important lesson. And that means that early detection and early action, it's not just the detection, but the action that are really key. Now, Ebola spreads in a population not in a continuous way. It goes by waves. And that has to do with so-called super-spreading events. And a lot of them have to do with funerals. That was the case in West Africa. And the more famous a person is, the more people will come to a funeral, like anywhere else in the world. And because of the funeral rites, the moving way of saying goodbye to a loved one mean that people touch the dead body, the body is washed and so on. Stories are told about how great a person that was and a good person and so on. But what is a moving way of saying farewell to the dead has turned into a fatal way of saying farewell. And so you can see here, and there are multiple stories now, of clusters of 10, 20, 80 cases that were all infected by that one person. Because we know that one is most infectious when you have Ebola, before dying, but then also just after death. There's plenty of virus in all your body fluids, lots of vomiting, diarrhea, blood, and then when you wash that body with your naked hands, that's the maximum exposure. And then another one is caring for someone, not for the dead. Now, for the first time ever also, there were cases exported to other countries. In the first place, to other countries in the region, highly publicized in Nigeria. They did a great job in containing it. The same thing was true for Mali, Senegal, where there were actually no secondary cases, and in Nigeria, only a few. And then what really caught the most international attention and the most tweets, there were like 100 times as many tweets about case admitted in Texas than about the whole epidemic in West Africa. That tells another story of our world today. And there were more tweets about the dog of the Spanish nurse. Excalibur, I think. Why do I remember the name of that dog? But then about the nurse itself. And so in Spain, and there were cases expatriated to in the UK and France and Germany and so on. That was the first time, illustrating that what is the beginning, a local or regional outbreak had major international ramifications and boosting the cost of this epidemic many, many fold. Now, a few new things happened in this outbreak also that we didn't really know. First is that it's clear now today that sexual transmission is possible. Of course, I've worked for much of my life about sexually transmitted infections, HIV, so for me, anything can be transmitted sexually. But this is a good proof. Already in 1976, we had isolated from the seminal fluid of a lab technician in Portendown. This is a maximum security lab in the UK, near London. We had isolated Ebola from his seminal fluid. He had been infected accidentally. But there was no proof that this had any epidemiological or clinical meaning. Today we know it's a case. Look here at the curve for Liberia. In Liberia, the epidemic was declared over earlier this year, I think it was June or May, I can't remember. And then several weeks later, there was a new cluster appeared of cases. And 2 weeks ago, there were two papers in the New England Journal of Medicine clearly demonstrating, using also genomic typing of the isolates of these of that transmission chain, that this was a case of sexual transmission. We know today that the virus can be secreted in urine, but in semen, and up to at least nine months. We don't know yet for how long. There are about 7,000 male survivors of Ebola in West Africa. How many of them are excreting Ebola in their semen, we don't know. And so there are studies going on of cohorts of survivors that are trying to establish that risk and what the facts are. There are also, and this is an important issue. Why? Because theoretically, it could really be a continuous source of Ebola in a community, and also give rise to new epidemics when all the circumstances, when a mini perfect storm comes together. For example, someone is buried, through funeral rites, people are becoming infected. And we know also from seroprevalence survey. What is a seroprevalence survey? It's a survey you take blood from in a population and you try to detect antibodies, in this case to Ebola virus. And these antibodies are an indicator that one was had been infected earlier on in life with Ebola virus. And it's interesting to see, and hoping that the tests are totally accurate, in other words, no false positives, that in this is in Central Africa, but also in Sierra Leone already in 2006, 2008, in that particular survey, 8.6% of people had antibodies. And when you could ask questions to them, some remember that they had, had symptoms that are compatible with Ebola, others not. So is there subclinical infection, asymptomatic infection? We don't know. And it's another important question that we have to resolve. Now, Ebola is, in itself, you can say, how is it so, why do we spend so much time? 10,000 deaths or 11,000 deaths in three countries over nearly 2 years, that is not that much. Why is Ebola so important? And the main reason for that is that it shuts down basically a country. It shuts down in the first place the health system, because those who are in charge of it, nurses, doctors, other healthcare workers, they're exposed, they die. Over 500 doctors and nurses and lab workers and so in West Africa died from Ebola. So in other words, you can't, if you break your leg, you can't go to a hospital, there's nobody left. And probably more people died from other causes because of that shutdown of the health system than because of Ebola. Here, it's a complicated slide, but first of all, these countries lost a substantial number of healthcare workers, doctors, nurses, and midwives, and they already are so badly off. That's the first thing. So that's a long-term consequence. We also see that there was an increase in maternal mortality, an increase between 38 and over 100%. So more women died because they couldn't. There was no place to go. Infant mortality, under five mortality. So that's one thing. Secondly, all the schools were closed. So the education system for a year was closed down. Commerce came to a halt. And there were huge community reactions. It came at a time that the harvest was there, that farmers couldn't sell their goods and so on. And there were major incidents in the community in all countries, particularly in Guinea and in some of the slum areas in capitals. For understandable reasons, also because the response was not always well organized or was purely repression and military. But it means that we have to listen far better to what people think, before we start putting in place measures. And then the question was also, all this external assistance, these new Ebola treatment units, did they make any difference? It's not a controlled experiment. We will never really know. But what's clear is that after many months of inaction, and when finally, after September 2014, international aid came in, together with strong community responses, hospital beds were, for Ebola treatment units were put in, became functional. It's clear that this is according to some modeling from our John Edmonds group at our school that appeared last week in PNAS. And they suggest that the additional beds saved about 56,000 lives. But also, if these beds would have been available 1 month earlier, about 14,000 extra cases would have been saved. So, and one of the big messages that I would like to make is that act early. If you don't act early, the sooner you act, the bigger the savings you are. And now, a silver lining in this whole epidemic is that for the first time ever in such a dramatic outbreak, research happened. Research on the ground, from anthropological social research to epidemiological research, but also research on new treatments, potential treatments, and research on new vaccines. And one was already published. This is a trial with a VSV vaccine that was developed in Canada. And that was, the study was designed in such a way that it tried to contain an epidemic. So in other words, when a case was identified, the people who were in contact of that case, the ring, so-called ring, were given the vaccine immediately or later. And the trial suggested that this vaccine was highly effective. More studies are continuing, also with other vaccines that our school is involved with this trial, but also with another one with this is now marketed by Merck, and another vaccine by GSK, and one by J&J. They're also being evaluated. And it may be that we need two different vaccines, one for immediate containment of the epidemic and one for the long-term protection in the first place of healthcare workers. And this whole, the fact that we could do research was good, but we could have done much better. It's clear that our current R&D systems and systems for innovation in terms of vaccine is not fit for purpose when it comes to this kind of epidemics. One, there's no market incentive really to do it. There was not even a public health incentive, because the vaccines were developed, the candidate vaccines were developed and funded by biosecurity, anti-bioterrorism type of concerns. That's why they were developed up to a certain point, but they had never been tested in humans. So what we need is what is being called for here by people you may recognize, Stanley Plotkin, Adel Mahmoud, and Jeremy Farr, that the need for another mechanism. A mechanism, public-private type of partnership, that will provide incentives to develop vaccines against emerging infections and in epidemics such as Ebola. And I'm sure we'll come back to that over the course of the day. Now, from Ebola to the rest, let's put that in context. Ebola was probably, together with AIDS, as the real, these are the two defining epidemics of our time, but there have been many more epidemics. At any time of the day, of the year, there is an epidemic going on somewhere in the world. Are they avoidable? Are plagues inevitable, as William asked? The answer is no, but what's inevitable and evitable and avoidable is the size of it. But and I'll tell you why I think they will always be there. But here, when you look at Asia, where we've had major epidemics of respiratory infections, which are far more contagious and far bigger threat than Ebola for the rest of the world, here we see some examples now from so-called Nipah that started in Malaysia and came out of pig farms And then we had outbreaks now in still going on in Bangladesh. SARS was mentioned, MERS, and I'll say a few words about that. And then the mother of all epidemics is influenza. The flu, because of its constant mutation and combination, recombinations that are happening, particularly in birds, but also other animals, we will always see flu epidemics coming up, and most of the time coming out of Asia, although we had one coming out of Mexico. MERS is the latest one that caught the attention, and again, we thought it was limited to the Middle East, with cases detected like here in the, you know, or in the UK, but mostly and still going on in around you know, in the Middle East, Saudi Arabia and others, because camels are the main reservoir between, or the main source for people. But then in Korea, we had this major outbreak. So that's another illustration of something that happens in one part of the world next week and cause a major epidemic in other parts of the world. We saw it with SARS, Hong Kong, Toronto. So that's why dealing with an epidemic far away, thousands of kilometers away, is actually a global public good because it protects the rest of the world also. And that's the economic and political rationale for also supporting countries that are affected by it. Now, what all these new epidemics and these emerging infections have one thing in common. They all come from other animals than we human primates. In the case of Ebola, it's most probably a bat. We have, you know, the flu with all kinds of birds and so on. And what the drivers are, drivers that are actually intensifying over time. And that's why it's probably predictable that we will see more of these outbreaks, at least the beginning as time goes by. Because when you just hear, this is a slide from Owale Tomori from Nigeria, there is ecological change because of demographic push. You know, people are going to live now where before there was forest, international travel and trade, environmental pollution, agricultural practices, climate change, and all that. So all that together means that we were more and more exposed to animals and all that. And the spectrum of animals that are can be a source of these emerging pathogens is quite vast. Here is a, you know, you see all the animals that are sources of the various types of type A influenza virus. And so although it's birds that are the number one spec, and then often there is an intermediary also. So we cannot deal with these epidemics in humans without also thinking and considering what's going on in people. And for Ebola, this has been now mapped by, this is from Simon Hayes' group at Oxford, where you can see that the potential host, the reservoir of the virus, is not only limited to Central Africa, where we saw most of the epidemics, but also in West Africa, because we are an accidental host for, you know, for Ebola. We are a lousy host for Ebola virus, because a host that's killed within a week or two by, you know, by that virus means that that virus has to jump into another host, because viruses can only survive in the presence of living cells. Now, so they're all zoonoses. And the most important epidemic of contemporary times that we've seen was also a zoonosis, and that's HIV, and coming from a chimpanzee. In my lab, Martin Peters, many years ago, isolated for the first time a so-called simian immunodeficiency virus from a chimpanzee, wild-caught in Gabon and then in Congo also, and that was the missing link. And it has 98% homology, genetic homology with the human virus, but it's different. Anyway, we also share 98% of our genes with the genome with the chimpanzee. Now, HIV is an example of an epidemic that can become endemic. What does that mean? First, it was epidemic, first documented in gay populations in America and so on, huge epidemics in Africa, in the former Soviet Union, they're driven by injecting drug use in Southeast Asia. But now it is kind of, you know, endemic in the way that every year there are about 2 million new infections in the world. It's definitely not over. 1.2 million people die. And it is not so, it's something that has adapted very well to the human host. And that's probably also because the source of infection, the chimpanzee, is much closer to us than a bat. And so before the you know, Ebola virus will adapt to us, that's going to take much more time. Coming near the end, also to say that in terms of the political response and what we can do, there are, I was saying that AIDS and Ebola are the two defining epidemics because there are many things in common. The international response, special efforts, but also there were the two only health issues that have ever been discussed at the UN Security Council. This was the first session of the new millennium in January 2000, where you see then Vice President Al Gore leading a debate with my boss Kofi Annan then, a debate on AIDS in Africa. And then the second one was last year on Ebola. And I think for a crisis like that, that's the right level of discussion. And that's where it should be brought. Now, what's the future and what are our risks? This is an assessment of where we think, or the authors there, Chrétien et al., assess that there is a high risk for outbreaks of risk. And it's basically the whole world, but with different types of, you know, of pathogens. And there is a global health security that's been pushed by the US government, particularly concerned about, from the perspective of security, which it is a matter of national security, though in Europe, you would probably look at it a bit differently. But it is has three major sections, and there are about 60 countries now that have signed off on this. One is to prevent, and here again, to address William Fung's question, some of these are man-made, directly or indirectly. Indirectly, as I mentioned, all the circumstances that led to Ebola and to the emergence of zoonotic diseases, but more directly, antimicrobial resistance. A big epidemic that is looming, that is, and that we can do something about. So it's prevention, detection, and response, and all this will come up. For me, these are seven lessons that I take from the recent epidemics. First of all, you know, coming back to no future in infectious diseases, say that emerging infections will continue to arise from animals. Regardless, this will continue to happen as sophisticated our world may become. And that's fine, we just have to make sure that we are prepared for it. Secondly, in the case of AIDS particularly, the response has been driven very much by two things. One, the rapid adoption of science and innovation to the response. Very rapidly, far more than we are used to in endemic diseases and so on. But also driven by human rights. The fact that there are now 15 million people on antiretroviral therapy in the world in low and middle income countries is entirely due not to the science but to the fact that this was driven by human rights and say we cannot accept a world where those who cannot pay will die because they cannot have access to life-saving drugs. And then, you know, very practical solutions were found. Thirdly is that we need to listen to people. And there's a central role of people. In the case of HIV, there was people living with HIV. In the case of the Ebola outbreak, we saw a shift. Initially, it was epidemiologists and say, boom, this was necessary, and it was quasi-military approach. And then we started thinking, okay, what does it mean? Why are these funeral rites? Why do they happen? What do they mean for people? How can we make them safe? Fourth is that politics can make an enormous difference, positive or negative. And this is where leadership comes in, where you know, taking difficult decisions can make an enormous difference. And of course, thanks to politics, there will be money. Fifth is that we need specific mechanisms for, I mentioned, research and development, be it for vaccines, for example. We will need a global vaccine facility fund for this kind of infections. but also funding and control. And lastly, I would say that without stronger systems, public health and health systems, it will be very difficult to absorb the shocks and to prevent major outbreaks or small outbreaks to become major. And act properly, I would say, is the very important thing. So the question for me is really, will Ebola be a game changer for global health, just as AIDS was a game changer? Global health is a term that didn't even exist until the millennium. But AIDS changed that. It brought it really to the place where it will be. So I won't go into details. But now, in terms of lessons, there are at least four panels, commissions that are looking into the, what's going on, or what went wrong and what was going well in terms of the response to Ebola. One is an internal commission in WHO that already issued its report and was quite critical of the WHO's response. There's a panel that I'm leading, chairing with the Harvard School of Public Health, the Global Health Initiative, and that report will come out at the end of November. We have the Institute of Medicine, the National Academy of Medicine in the US, addressing it, and then there is the UN, the Secretary General of the UN is also. So we'll see what comes out of it, because it's really the least we can do to the 11,000 people who died is to make sure that next time we do a better job, because we didn't do as an international community. The question that's always looming there is who will do the job. There is a disconnect between there where we have the highest risk of epidemics and where there is often the lowest capacity, as you can see on this slide. Now, last year, this is the last slide, last year for my 65th birthday, my wife Heidi and I went to Zaire. We were probably the only tourists there, and wanted to DRC. And I wanted to have a look where, Ebola Ground Zero. This was we published an article on it in the FT Weekend magazine, and which is far more read than any scientific journal. I can tell you that. And we wanted to have a look what was going on, and it was sobering. Because in January 1977, WHO organized a meeting in London, and where the commitment was made by lots of member states and so on, never again, we will invest in health systems, we will do this, we will do that, and so on, lots of promises. And what happened? Nothing. Nothing happened. The commitment was to support regions that were under threat for Ebola, and so here you see in this last year, the hospital in Yambuku, where you see a survivor of Ebola. This is Mr. Sukato, who is a nurse who survived Ebola in 76, is now the head of the laboratory of that hospital, and you can see his equipment, a decent microscope. This is his centrifuge with hand, and then this is all his reagents. And they're abandoned by everybody. And because of civil war, the situation is much worse. And so I was thinking, whenever Ebola hits that place again, it'll be the same disaster. So let's make sure this time we don't let it happen, and that all these commissions, all this suffering, and all this energy will be used to prevent major outbreaks. And I think that this is what we should discuss the next few days. Thank you very much. Hello.
So one question that I had is about some of the challenge between balancing community buy-in with the need to act promptly, it seemed like some of the issues that arose were because due to the lack of trust in the governments, people were resistant to some of the discussions of like what preventative measures people should take. However, it also seems that if you start involving like too many discussions with community leaders about what like should be done and how to best balance that with their culture, it ends up making it a much slower process, and obviously that's not the most effective. So how do you think you can manage that balance between engaging with the community to achieve that buy-in, but also retaining the speed of action?
Yeah. Yeah, that's always a dilemma. That's the dilemma of dictatorship versus democracy, I guess. But you need to find the right balance. On the one hand, it depends a bit on the epidemic. In the case of Ebola, we had experience to a certain degree of smaller outbreaks, but nobody had been confronted with this large-scale outbreak. So the classic paradigm was isolation, containment, and that worked in the past, but you can't put entire countries in isolation, even if that's what was attempted. Let's not forget that there is no incentive for a country to declare that they have Ebola or something like that, because what happened, British Airways, Air France, they all stopped their flights, you know, the boats did no longer come to the harbor and so on. So the countries were isolated. So we had to learn while we were sailing. But I think that the what you can do is a combination. First, you try what makes the best sense. You have to take care of people who are dying and suffering. So that's a humanitarian imperative. But in this case also, it helps to shield off the patients who are infectious from those who are not infected. And always, I think you need to think also, where is the transmission occurring? I didn't show the facts here, but it's clear that most infections were occurring in the community. And there was a lot of, in the beginning, was purely epidemiological approach, but then as more and more, like on the academic side, social scientists became involved and anthropologists and so on, and I think that helped a lot. Although I had some big discussions, some anthropologists said, okay, I need to spend 2 years in that village to understand what people think. We don't have the time for that. So what I thought we needed more were kind of social marketing people who can do a snapshot and understand it rapidly what's going on. But that has to be done by people from that community. And that we didn't do enough. And in MSF, there's a big internal discussion where the self-critique is that indeed we should have listened more to people. But you can do that also. This is not an academic exercise. You just sit down and you ask. I remember when we were in Zaire, just went into the villages, sit down with people and let them talk what they think is happening. And then you put it all together. But I think that the one of the lessons is really, as for in every epidemic, you need multiple disciplines and approaches. And I, for example, we, working with radios, with people who are in touch with consumers, I think these are very, very precious individuals and expertise that we didn't use enough. Thank you. Hello.
Yes. Is there a pattern to these Ebola outbreaks, or are they totally random? And what is the geography of Ebola in Africa? It had not ever happened before in West Africa, as I understand it. And so the people there had no familiarity with it. Can you give us some sense of both the geography, potentially, of Ebola outbreaks, and sort of how likely is it that we'll see this again in the next few years?
Yeah, 2 years ago, I would have answered you with quite some confidence what the patterns are. Today, I'm not so sure anymore. Because the patterns were, in the first place, geographically in Central Africa, and as so often, the best predictor of the future is the past. And so most epidemics, 25 actually, have occurred in Central Africa. So it's very likely that they will occur there again. But the best predictor probably will be if we would know much more precisely where the virus is hiding. Where is the virus reservoir? That's why I showed you this map from Simon Hayes' group about the distribution of the certain fruit bats in Africa. And because they're the reservoir from although we still have to absolutely confirm that that's the case. And if we know exactly where the virus reservoir is, that's at least the first catchment area. And we could map that out for other emerging infections as well. But then I think whether a small outbreak will grow to a big one, that will depend then on more, is there an infrastructure? Is there capacity for early diagnosis and so on? For example, in DRC, in Congo, they can now diagnose Ebola infection in Kinshasa. They don't have to send the samples to Europe or to the US. And that's a capacity that should be present in every single country. That doesn't mean a high containment, so-called category 4 laboratory. Now, that may be even dangerous and extremely expensive anyway to maintain. But so that's the knowledge of the reservoir is going to be absolutely critical, and that's where I would put a lot of research in.
Is it definitely in bats, by the way? Is it in bats?
Well, what's the evidence for bats? The virus itself, Ebola virus, has never been isolated from bats, the live virus. That's the case for Marburg infection, this cousin of Ebola. What's the evidence? Pieces of RNA, the genetic material of Ebola, have been detected in bats in Gabon and in a few other countries now. So that's quite strong evidence. And then secondly, maybe a bit bizarre experiment, but in a laboratory in South Africa, various animals were infected with Ebola. And all died except the bat. And bats are very special animals in terms of their immunological system. They very rarely develop cancer, for example. They can live in harmony with all kinds of viruses. So that's as much as we have as evidence. And then some stories also. But this is a very urgent research that needs to happen. Yes, sorry, I can't see.
My question relates to vaccines, and it's great that vaccines are now being produced to Ebola. But I wonder how are we going to get vaccines out to the regions that are needed? And the question is because measles is still a huge problem in Africa, even though we have really good vaccines, we can't get them out to where it's needed. So in your opinion, what can be done to address that question?
Yeah, good question. Well, first of all, we have to demonstrate beyond doubt that the vaccines work, that they protect. For which circumstance? As I mentioned, we may even need two vaccines, one for in case of outbreak containment and one for long-term protection. So that research has to continue in the meantime. But let's assume we have one. And your point is very right. I mean, when you look at immunization levels in the three countries during the outbreaks, they collapsed. And, you know, because of the health system was not there. And vaccine coverage in African countries is very mixed. Some have very good vaccine coverage and others not. And then I would say, what I would say is that assuming that we know far better now where are the countries and populations at risk, because we know about the reservoir and so on, that vaccine may have to be included in the regular immunization programs. But that's then also a matter of cost. Gavi, for example, has now purchased, I understand, already the Merck vaccine. So there is some money put aside. My priority would be to vaccinate healthcare workers, because just imagine that you can treat Ebola patients just as like anybody else, or with a bit of minimal or regular precaution. That would be a game changer. Because you don't need the Ebola treatment units. They're very complex to manage. Healthcare workers could do other things as well, would not have to fear for their own life all the time. And you know, the contact now, when you're in such a protection gear, you can't have really normal contact with patients. You can't put an IV drip in an easy way and so on and so on. So that's what I would say is a priority. Thank you.
Hi,
can you also identify yourself? It would be always nice to know
to whom
Hi,
you speak.
My name is Aileen Kitching. I'm a public health doctor here in Ireland, and I was the WHO lead for contact tracing in Sierra Leone from February to April this year. One of the comments we heard in communities a lot was there was a lack of engagement of women and of traditional healers in the response, particularly in the initial phases. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on that.
So my experience with traditional healers and women also?
There was a lack of engagement. I know from many meetings I went to, there was very few
Sorry,
women
the
engaged.
Sound, the lack of?
Engagement of women in the response.
Yeah.
And a lack of engagement of traditional healers.
Yeah. Well, I think that so many things, starting with traditional healers, they can be, contribute to the spread as is happening, just like churches. There were churches who asked for people to come in to heal with their hands and touching and so on, and that gave rise to outbreaks and some healers. But on the other hand, a traditional healer is a very important person in a community. And if you can get them on your side, then they can really play a very important role also to make funerals not only safe but dignified. And women, I don't know. I mean, I think it makes so good sense. Women are the carers, in many societies. But you asked the question, but I think you have the answer probably yourself. Yes. Thank you. Yes, please.
Shona King, ERM Foundation. As you say, live virus has not yet been isolated in bats, but there does seem to be consensus that Ebola is or emerges from forest locations. And I wonder to what extent you think, as part of this debate, we should be looking at land use and forest management, going back to patient zero or the index case before human-to-human transmission is able to even occur. Should we be looking at that place where the virus first jumps from one animal to one human being? And to what extent do you think that land use change in many of these countries is a relevant factor to be looking at?
Sorry, I really didn't mean this hard time.
It's okay. I said going back to the patient zero.
Patient
zero, the index case.
Yes.
Where the virus first passes from the bat or whichever animal is the host to the human being. There seems to be some evidence that land use change and forest conditions make that more likely to occur.
Yeah.
And I wonder, from your experience working in this field, what you feel, do you feel that that issue is being looked at, the kind of environmental drivers?
Yeah. Now the change, the sound, now I hear you perfectly. There was some problem here. Thank you. Yeah, I mean, as I mentioned in one of the slides, I mean, there are, why do we have more zoonosis? Because of a change also in environment. The fact that there's more deforestation, population pressure, people live where before there were only animals. Also, one of the things that was striking when we went back to the Equator province in DRC, I hadn't been there since 1986, the one thing that was changed was far more people and mobile phones. I mean, that's about the two things. But that we were told that hunting is going on deeper and deeper in the forest. People eat the proteins that are available. You know, we eat deer here and so on, and chicken and what have you, and fish. But the whether direct deforestation, for example, which has been mentioned, is directly, can be directly attributed as a cause of Ebola, I think it's one of the several factors. We also don't know exactly, when you think of a bat, is this a direct infection, like bat feces or urine on food or whatever, or people eat bats, while preparing the bat, I don't know. Or is there an intermediary, which is also possible? I think we have a lot of ecological studies that have to be done. Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Then the last one over there.
Hi, my name is Saivi. I'm a final year medical student from Trinity College. And you mentioned that in the Democratic Republic of Congo, they contained an outbreak in last August in 6 weeks. How well equipped do you think the countries in West Africa would be now to deal with the recurrence of Ebola in such an effective way?
Yeah, I think that when you look at certainly Uganda, they have in Entebbe, there's a lab that's actually run by Centers for Disease Control at the Uganda Virus Research Institute, where they can diagnose Ebola immediately, plus other hemorrhagic fevers, Ebola, Marburg. And they have field stations, and there is a whole system that was set up. Congo is less well equipped, but because it's also huge. It's the Congo DRC is as big as the whole of Europe. But they're very alert to it. But I think that these are probably, and Gabon probably as well, that these are the two only, or the three only countries where that works well. I don't think that the equipment and the laboratory infrastructure is that well organized. But I should say, take Senegal. Senegal had one case, and really they did a fantastic job. We talk always about, Nigeria, but in Nigeria they were very lucky, but they were relying on the polio eradication, setup for contact tracing, and the luck was that the patient who came from Liberia was admitted to a private hospital, where there was a doctor who was really a leader in the community. And recognized this as Ebola, and actually died herself from the infection. With what we need is a strong investment in this kind of infrastructure. And that's not a very complicated infrastructure, but each country must have at least one laboratory where, that can be a place where they can diagnose this kind of infections. Whether it's so-called epidemiological surveillance. And that's a proposal that the Chancellor, George Osborne in the UK, put on the table just before the last elections, actually, to establish a so-called Fleming Fund that would invest in this kind of capacity. And also at the G7 meeting in Berlin, the summit in June, the commitment was there to support 60 countries to establish such a system. The problem is there was no budget attached to it and no timeline, so when I don't see that, I'm always a bit skeptical. But we need, it's absolutely necessary. Again, I feel that particularly for the low-income countries, of course it's in their interest to do that, but it's also in the interest of the world as a whole to invest in that. Thank you. Thank you.